This episode is brought to you by War for the Tower podcast. The War for the Tower is an actual play podcast set in the world of Stephen King's Dark Tower. As the Dark Tower includes elements of every possible universe, including those from literature and pop culture, the characters are all over the map. There's a drow elf psychic, Magnus Bane, High Warlock of Brooklyn, Hezekiah Staunton, Gunslinger of Midworld, and many more. The settings include New York City circa 2020, a world in which JFK lived and served a second term, and the Vietnam War ended in 65, and a blown-to-crap version of Midworld. Our heroes are given an important mission to save all universes, and we have a fun, sexy time along the way. Check out the first episode at warforthetower.com.
This is an Unspoiled Network podcast.
This is Unspoiled, covering The Dresden Files, Book 9, White Knight, Chapters 14, 15, and 16. In these chapters, Harry finally puts Little Chicago to use. And it looks like that's a wrap on Little Chicago. Welcome to Unspoiled. I'm a rolling thunder, pouring rain. I'm coming down like a hurricane. My lightning's flashing across the sky. You're only young, but you're gonna die. I won't take no prisoners once we're to the show, everybody. I am Natasha.
I'm Rashawn.
So, ma'am, what did you think about this use of our friend Little Chicago that you have been wanting to see Harry finally this do something with?
Well, we saw it before in the last book.
Right, true.
But this was much, he spent much more time this time, and encountered people, which I don't think we really had much of the first time we saw it.
Mm-hmm.
and someone encountered him, which who knew that was possible?
I know, right? That just doesn't feel quite fair.
When we got to that moment and Cowl starts looking around the room, I was like, oh shit, is he going to see? And then bam!
He not only sees, he like fucking headbutts him,
basically,
you know,
and like sends Harry, like, you know, hurtling out back into his fucking body.
Oh my god.
Which you know, I mean, when we met Cowl the book or two ago, I guess it's two books now, he was powerful as fuck, and I wasn't sure that it was the same guy, and we don't know that until, you know, Harry talks about it.
Mm-hmm.
But when he headbutts him and sends Harry flying, I was like, that seems about right.
So you mean it seems about right in that that is what Cowl is capable of?
Yes, yes.
Okay,
like
gotcha.
that power and ass whooping seems familiar.
Mm-hmm. That's fair.
But even better than Little Chicago was a talk with Bob about Mouse.
Oh yeah,
which
yeah, yeah.
I have been desperate to hear more about. What exactly a temple dog is and what it can do. And I was not disappointed by Bob's story. Now, Bob says, you know, it's a lot of myth and lore, you know, and mm-hmm. No one's really 100% sure, but there are like some stories that sort of could overlap, and maybe in the ones that overlap, there's kernels of truth.
Right.
So this might not be like the definitive answer to what Mouse's deal is, but I was super happy to just get any kind of talk about it.
Yeah, I think that's fair. You're just desperate for scraps of information.
I am. And especially after, you know, how he showed off in those last chapters. Mouse, I mean.
Yeah, right.
I was really, really wanting to, you know. I wasn't sure. I was really, really hoping to hear more about what we think was going on with that. So yeah, three really good chapters with a lot of information because, well, it's weird because we got a lot of information, but Harry can't really see who's talking because of the way the spell works. So we don't know for sure who Harry saw, but he's got a pretty strong theory. Which gets, like, kind of fucked.
Yes,
it does. Last minute. So, these chapters felt like I got a lot of answers. And then when you take a step back, you're like, oh, wait. Did we really get a lot of answers?
Harry really congratulates himself a little too hard too quickly.
Thinking
that he has. And I love how there's that moment of him being like, so I'm pretty sure it's this. And Murphy is like, well, but he's dead, though. And Harry just keeps on talking about the thing that he's so sure on and then has to stop and be like, wait, excuse me, what? I'm sorry. It sounded like you said the thing that I'm positive about is impossible, but I know that can't be correct.
He's like, is he dead? Are we sure he's dead? Did he fake his death?
Because listen, we all know that everybody in everything that died but we didn't see a body could potentially be alive.
Right. I thought that we were going to find out that this guy, what's his name, Beckett, is like a vampire himself. I thought for sure that's where Harry was going.
I like that.
But Harry didn't think that, so I'm like, well, okay, I was just being a little nutty. Let me calm down.
I mean, is that nutty? I don't think that's nutty.
But I feel like, well, you know, they do have a lot of talk about how you don't always recognize a vampire when you're talking about the White Court vampires. Mm-hmm. And they had Karen and Harry have a long conversation about how he didn't know Thomas was one, how they didn't know that Darby Crane was one until, you know, only because Harry, on some level, recognized him as a wraith.
Right.
And didn't even realize that he's explained to Karen that it was just sort of an instinct. It wasn't like an actual, I know that this guy's a vampire kind of thing.
Right.
But we kind of jumped all around.
Yeah, we have.
So.
Well, we're just taking a very comprehensive view. And I think that everybody should be grateful to us. And just back off, okay, guys? All right, so I do want to bring to attention this one thing real quick. Simple wire shelves covered three walls, stacked up high with books and containers of various ingredients I would use, like the thick sealed lead box that contained an ounce and a half of depleted uranium filings, and loaded down with various objects of arcane significance, like the bleached human skull that occupied its own shelf along with several paperback romance novels, or professional curiosity, like the collection of vampire fangs the wardens in the United States, me and Ramirez, had gathered in the course of several skirmishes over the past year. Does that strike you?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. We were going to talk about that.
That's like the grill on the guy he shot from Breaking Bad kind of shit.
Yeah. This is and it feels familiar to me, but I can't place it. But this taking of the fangs as souvenirs.
Taking and of the fangs.
It is really dark for the Harry that I feel like we know up to this point.
Right.
And seems wildly out of character. But this is like the second or third time where there's been a very quick reference to some shit that's happening that has not, that's completely off page. Right?
Yeah, true.
These these warden council missions in like, I don't know, like acts of war or fucking, I don't know what the fuck, but where it's not being included in the story, but the little snippets we're getting, I don't care for it. And Harry Dresden keeping souvenir fangs from vanquished vampires does not jibe.
Yeah.
With anything else we know about him. So I don't know really where to put that.
It's sort of like, I feel like, I feel like people might argue that, like, well, you know, it's like taking a unicorn horn. Or, like, just any sort of, like, piece of an animal, basically, that you want to know more about. And, yeah, and that you killed. But I just can't, with the fact that vampires are, like, conscious creatures. They're not, like...
Listen.
And I'm not trying to say unicorns aren't conscious creatures. They're fictional, but that's beside the point.
So without getting into a whole thing... I am not a fan of people who mount deer heads or bear heads or any other, like, you know.
Yeah.
To me, it's the same sort of thing here.
Now, I want to point out, though, he's not, like, mounting these things on the wall. They're in a jar, and he calls it professional curiosity. Like, this is supposed to be, like, I don't know.
Are you taking it like it's research or something?
That's what I feel like he's framing it as. But I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know. Because when he says professional curiosity, like, on its face, we think of Harry Dresden as being a professional wizard, a professional investigator.
Mm-hmm.
But he's also, like, a warden now. And that's another profession he has.
Yeah.
And that's where I was. But I mean, I don't know, like, it may not be meant to be taken quite as unseemly as I'm taking it.
I mean, maybe it's not meant to be, but I was brought up short by it. Mm. So and as soon as I started to bring it up, you were immediately like, yeah, what the fuck.
Yeah, yeah, well, yeah, like I said, we were going to talk about this.
Yeah, so I feel like that's not us taking it any way that, like, that's what it feels like is being said.
Yeah, and, like, if you think of the wardens, and again, guys, I haven't gotten a real accounting of what's been happening out on those, I guess, warden streets. I don't know, like, I don't know.
Indeed.
You know what I mean? But, like, if we think for a second, like, what I would imagine is the council is actively at war, and the wardens are being sent out to handle certain situations, you know. I don't know if they're being used as, like, a military unit, but that's kind of what it feels like.
Mm-hmm.
And I know... only from what other people say, you know, no personal experience, obviously, but there can be, when you're in a unit like that and you are forced to fight an adversary that is trying to kill you, that sometimes that can have an effect on people and you know, some of the choices they make about how they consider their opponent can be kind of dehumanizing. You
right.
know what I mean?
Yeah. Oh, no, and, definitely. And
dehumanizing isn't super fair because Harry's literally fighting vampires. So they're not human, but I think you guys get, like, what I'm saying
mm-hmm,
here.
Mm-hmm.
So I know he frames this professional curiosity, but I have to say it felt immediately like a trophy.
Mm.
It just did. It felt like a trophy, which is why I went to, like, you know, mounted heads and bears and deers and stuff, because that's what those are. Those are trophies.
Mm-hmm.
So it would be super cool if this turns out to be something completely different, and it turns out that Harry was researching a way to make fangs less dangerous. Or, you know, a spell that when a vampire tries to bear his fangs at you, he can do a spell and they just like pop back up into his mouth.
Oh my God.
You know?
This is that so goofy now. I am still here for it, to be honest, but...
You know, I would love for it to turn out to be that he is keeping these things to learn something, you know, mm-hmm. or to improve something. That would be great. But it's not what I thought.
That would be great. Not holding my breath at all. I am relieved, though, that you felt the way that I did on instinct. Because I don't want to think the worst. Mm-hmm. But there is just something about that combined with, like, later. Well, there's... I'm not going to talk about it. Because I'm realizing that I think that when I listened to the audiobook this time, I over-listened. I overdid it. So I'm thinking about a moment a bit, like a conversation that I think happens in the chapter right after.
Oh, okay. All right.
But so, anyway, sorry.
Also, I mean, uranium fillings?
Filings?
Filings? God damn it.
You got so much more mad than I expected.
I just get tired of saying shit wrong.
Yeah, same.
It wears me down. you know, that's cool that he has that.
Yeah, don't you, like, want to know what that's for?
I want to know what it was for. It's depleted. What did you use it for? Mm. Where did you get it?
Yeah, did you buy that shit already depleted? Or,
you know, like, I know he's got crazy contacts and he's bought a lot of weird shit, especially when he was building Little Chicago. But, again... Maybe this isn't one of those side job stories, is it? I don't know.
It's an interesting thought.
But I would like to know more about that, yes. Also, it sucks that he has to keep it in this container because I don't even know how you can't really just dispose of that any old way, can you?
Yeah, I guess not. I mean, it's I would assume being in the lead-lined box, it's safe and it's fine.
Mm-hmm. One would hope.
Like, how long does something like that stay active? I guess is that called the half life?
I feel like this is something he probably has to keep safe for a really long time, which is good because he's going to live a long time if he doesn't get himself murdered.
That's true. And then he can just leave it to Molly, I guess.
Oh my God, somebody's going to have to come and try to. Oh, that's going down a really morbid path. Somebody having to come into his apartment and clean it out.
They fucking just pop it up. What's in here? I have a weird headache. They stir it around with their fingers. I don't know. God. It just looks like some, like, metal chips. What do you think you wanted? What do you think you needed this?
And then they just go and touch all their kids with their fingers.
God. Anyway, all right. We're getting a little silly.
Yeah. Okay. So, we have a reminder about what Little Chicago is and how he built it.
Mm-hmm.
We have... Bob being the bobbiest Bob that ever bobbed.
Listen.
It goes on for a minute.
Is he the creepiest?
It's super creepy. Harry is trying to just be like, can you not? And Bob is like, but can I though? And it just goes on and on. Harry is like, listen. She is not a cookie. She's not a biscuit. She's not a Pop-Tart. She's not a sweet tart. She's not an apple tart. Any other kind of pastry. And Bob immediately calls her a cupcake.
Bob, get thee behind me. He's like, yeah. I won't be able to see her in time.
Listen.
And Harry's like, in time?
In time.
For what? before she starts to droop.
I could have just tossed him right across the room.
Honestly. I got no patience for this. No, sir.
Listen, and then
I know it's supposed to be funny, but like, there is a part of me that genuinely does not find it funny. There's a part of me that sees that it's funny. Do you know how that is? Where you're like, on the one hand, but on the other hand,
Well, it's because that's exactly what it is. It's like, I get that it's a joke. I get this is a character that has been introduced to us ages ago. And has always been just like this. And he provides a certain amount of comic relief to the story and all that stuff. But it's like this, like, you can be funny up to the line. You don't always have to, like, barrel across it.
Mm-hmm.
And that last little, like, because even the way he says it, in time to behold her full, springy, nubile, youthful glory.
Yeah.
Which, okay. yeah, I get it that we are not as attractive when we get older and we start to droop. And thanks for reminding me of that.
Right.
that's super awesome. Thanks. Thanks for that. But again, it's just like, you didn't have to lean so hard into that particular joke.
Yeah. I just, it's really the kind of thing that I'm not like angry about it. It's just, it comes down to it being a matter of taste, I think. And for me, you get to a point where it's not about the joke anymore. And it starts to be a little bit more about the truth.
Mm.
And that's the part that really starts to feel like uncomfortable and gross.
Mm.
Where it's like, are you just sort of hiding behind this character in order to say the things that you really think? Is that what's happening here?
Well, isn't that always what's happening?
Is it?
I mean, I'm not saying, I'm just saying.
That's certainly a thing that could be. I don't know. I never run across this part of the story without kind of reacting this way to it. And especially in light of how you and I both felt about the way that the story was set up from the start with her involvement being, I'm going to have an orgasm in front of everybody.
Right.
There's
right.
just a combo here of, that makes me deeply uncomfortable.
It's this weird, and I don't, it's not weird. It's actually very fucking common in pedestrian, but there's this like continual reminder of not just Molly as like his young woman apprentice, but like, oh, don't forget she's super young and super hot.
Mm-hmm.
Like just make sure we're always remembering that,
yeah.
You know? And I don't know 100% what to do with that. And I'm hoping that it is not something that continues on. I'm hoping that she becomes, if she's going to stick around as a character, I hope that her story is not just going to be her being young and hot and this kind of weird, what do you call it? Like this off limits kind of thing that we're like low key lusting after all the time, but not really, really, you know what I mean?
Yep, yep.
I'm hoping that this is like a shtick that gets old super quick and she becomes something else to the story. So I'm trying to like, again, I've said it before at this point in the books, I feel like Butcher has earned enough trust that I feel confident talking about the moments that I don't like, but they don't make me want to put the books down. You know what I mean?
Right, yes.
I'm not like, oh, that's too much. It's across the line. I'm fed up. You know, it's not like that for me, but I do notice when it does that.
Yeah, I think that's the right description of how it feels. Because, like you said, it's not about oh, this is so offensive that I'm going to put it. It just is off-brand enough from how things have been set up so far, which I almost feel like that's a bit of a compliment. That when Bob acts up like this, we both are like, ew, what?
It feels very early bookish, right?
Yeah, it does. And maybe that's like part of the point is that Bob doesn't really change and grow.
Mm. Yeah. Oh, what a nice spin. Like, what if that is what's happening as a reminder that Harry has changed, but Bob hasn't. So it's kind of like almost like a side by side, you know? I don't know if that's intended or not, but I think I would prefer to think of that as that way.
Right, yeah.
You know? Because I feel like at the beginning of these books, even though Harry was never as bad as Bob, you know, the writing felt much more like Bob a lot of the time. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I do.
Like, even if it was unintentional, it was like there wasn't much difference between Bob and Harry when it came to certain things. And now it feels like there's a huge difference between them.
I think I could get behind that.
All right, it's canon now. So then we get to the good stuff.
Yes.
Bob starts to tell him what he knows about temple dogs. And these dogs are scions, so the story goes.
Yes.
A celestial being called a foo dog?
Yeah. I feel like Ancient Mai said something about this.
That's what he says, too.
Yeah, right. He does say that.
And a mortal canine. And the stuff we already knew. They're very intelligent and loyal and tough. And they're supposed to keep an eye out for dark spirits and dark energy. And they can alert others to the presence of danger.
Mm-hmm.
And so that they start talking about how he was able to just get the whole fucking building up on Ash's house.
So cool.
It was really cool. And I want one now. I think I deserve a temple dog. I need guarding. I need to be alerted to dark presence and dark energy. And I often oversleep through my alarm.
Oh my God. Can you imagine if you got given a scion of supernatural power and you just used him as a fucking snooze button, basically? And I forgot that he says, a lot of stories say that they can make themselves be heard from 50 or 60 miles away.
Mm.
It isn't just a physical thing either. It carries over into the never never and can be heard clearly by non-corporeal entities. It startles them and drives most of them away. And if any of them stick around, Mouse could take his teeth to them, even though they're spirits. That's wild.
I can't wait for this to be a thing that we get to see. I don't know when and how, but I cannot wait for it. Like, if there was a way he could take Mouse with him into Little Chicago.
Right. Yeah, that'd be awesome. He could have fucked
Cowl up right then.
Oh my God, you're so right. That'd be so cool if you figured out how to do that.
Oh God. So he calls him Super Dog and then thinks to himself that he better get him a Kevlar vest. And yes, Harry, you fucking better get him a vest.
Yeah, because when he says Super Dog, Bob is like, I mean, kind of. He could still be killed. I mean, we did see him get, like, hit by a car and, like, get back up. But it took a while. It wasn't like he just got right back up.
He was hurt. Yeah. But he recovered, you know. I was going to gloss over that part about being killed because I felt like we didn't need to put any energy into that sentence. But you just went ahead and said it out loud. So.
How could you put that out into the universe? So he asks Bob to give Little Chicago a once over and make sure that everything is neat and tidy and ready to go. And Harry reflects on something that Murphy said to him about teaching.
Yeah. I love this.
This is good, right?
A little bit. Yeah, this is good stuff. That you can only learn so much, and then you get to a point where you just basically can't be taught anything else. Mm-hmm. And the only way to keep learning is to teach others. And he says that he was just kind of like, whatever, dude. But it turns out, you know, like most things, she was right. Mm-hmm. And he has found, and I think he mentioned earlier in the book, too, that he had found that since taking Molly on as his apprentice, he had become better. Mm-hmm. You know, a better wizard, better understanding of his own power. And I read this part because he's getting himself ready to actually use Little Chicago. And he's, like, is able to center himself in, like, 10 minutes. And it made me think about how hard he had to work to center himself before.
Yeah.
It took, like, an hour, and then the phone rang and fucked him all.
Oh, my God. That will never not be funny to me. He took his damn time writing that chapter. Cackling the whole while, I'm sure.
Oh, God. So, yeah, so he's really come, you know, a long way. And so he's all set to go. He gets in there.
I'm sorry. He gets in there. I'm just remembering that moment still and the way the audiobook, like, and then the fucking phone rang right in my fucking ear. And he doesn't swear often. So when he swears in that moment, you're just really like, oh, shit. Ah, it's so good. Sorry.
No, it's okay. I always forget that you're listening to the audiobook. So for you, a lot of the stuff is, you know, like you, there are moments that you can remember clearly like that because of the way they're delivered.
Yeah.
All right. So he gets in there and...
You really need to listen to the audiobooks also, I'm telling you.
You know, I'm thinking about maybe...
They're so good.
I might go back and listen to them, yeah. I probably won't for, like, books as we're reading them, but I think I might go back and listen to some of the earlier ones.
It's kind of like, I honestly feel a little bit frustrated because I wasn't into audiobooks until reading these, and nothing is as good. Like, there's been a couple that I found that are pretty good. But there is something about these that's really special, and I can't seem to get the same kind of attachment to any other stories the way that I do with the way this is done.
Well, you've got, like, a great person reading these two, though.
He's so good. You know? Like, that's 100% what it is. It's just how good James Marsters is. He's amazing, yeah. And... it's the sort of thing where people talk about, like, well, what if it gets made into a TV show after all? And a lot of people have been saying, if they make it into a TV show, I want it to be animated so that James Marsters can still voice Harry Dresden.
Oh.
Which I think is genius. I'm, like, 100% in support of that.
Where are we?
Sorry. Everything's nominal. Oh. We're in the green, Captain.
Wait, what'd you say?
I said, everything is nominal. We're in the green, Captain. Because that's what Bob says to Harry when he asks how things are going. Only he does it in a Scottish accent. Which I will not subject anybody to my version of what that sounds like. Because it's highly offensive.
I thought you were just going to say it was bad.
I just it's bad enough to be offensive. Like, there is a point. I feel that way about food as well. If you cook something really badly, it's not just about the food anymore. It just gets to a point where it's like, no, I take offense to this. Like, the fact that you try to feed this to me means that you think less of me as a person than I thought you did.
This entree is a hate crime.
I swear to God, when you say it, it sounds absurd, but I feel that way. I do.
That's why I said it. I know how you feel.
Guys, Rashawn and I read our horoscopes before we started. And mine was basically like, ooh, you are kind of a pain in the ass, aren't you? You need shit exactly the way that you need it, or else you basically can't function at all, can you? And you take forever to make up your mind about shit, and you just want to make everybody happy and not get into conflicts. And I'm like, you know what? Go fuck yourself. Yes, this may be true. It's really funny to me because I'll have people who don't know me that well be like, I know that you love to get into it. And I'm like, not really.
Not really.
That's not my favorite. Like, I will. I've gotten to a point in my life where I'm much more willing to do it than I used to be. But, like, I really don't love that sort, especially, like, a face-to-face situation in which you're both just trying to have drinks and have a nice evening. But all of a sudden it gets ruined because somebody had to bring up Roe v. Wade.
Oh, my God.
Nobody likes that.
Trying to have a nice night out and somebody starts talking about the gay agenda.
Oh, my God.
Then you're like, oh, dude.
Yep.
Okay, fine.
Ruined my night out. Thanks a lot.
Right. So we're not going to have a nice night.
Yep.
Okay. All right.
Sorry. I'm very...
So.
You'd think that I was stoned. I'm not, I swear, but...
Same. all right. So, he gets in Little Chicago. He is able to basically... I don't know what to call this. He whooshes through the streets of Little Chicago. And so he's, like, practically, like, right up on the car with Grey Cloak.
Right.
But because of the way he did the spell and the little chip he got.
Yeah.
Right? So it's really focused on the car and not necessarily on the driver.
Mm-hmm.
So he can't really see Grey Cloak.
Yeah.
But he can hear him. And he is not alone. He gets company. A passenger gets in a car. And Harry can't see that motherfucker either.
Yeah, so frustrating.
But it's super frustrating because it's like they're like kind of a, like in the shadow, kind of just behind a, like a little bit blurry, mm-hmm. you know? And Harry says that he could probably focus his will and get a good look at him. But it probably wouldn't be a great idea to do that.
Yeah, he hasn't done a ton of testing on what using mm-hmm. Little Chicago in this capacity is like. So he doesn't want to, like, mess too much around right now. And later on, he realizes that, like, he might could die and not notice.
Oh, my God.
Like, he's sweating and turning, like, white and shaking. But
he's like looking up at his body and his body does not look great.
Yeah, his body is just like, and you know, he sort of asks himself, like, if I were down here and my body died, what then? Which that's a hell of a fucking question. Yeah. Indeed.
And there's like we don't know what would happen. Like, I would hope that he would just, if the will in the proper Harry Dresden is what's propelling him through the streets of Little Chicago in this spell, I would think that when he died, he would just die, right?
Mm-hmm.
But
I
am not a wizard. So I don't know for sure.
He thinks you protest too much.
As far as the listeners know, I am not a wizard.
I have no idea what would happen. I'm not a wizard.
She said very wizard.
Stroking her long beard.
So he is listening to this conversation between these two as yet to be identified evildoers.
Correct.
And this is not great.
No.
It
turns out that they're fucking, like, totally aware of how impulsive he is, re protecting women and using that for their own shit.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's just super disrespectful.
There's mention of Scavis, and I'm not going to lie, guys, I didn't remember that shit.
Scavis is how you want to say
Scavis.
That,
yeah. I didn't remember that at all.
I don't blame you.
So I didn't know what the fuck they were talking about.
I've read this shit a million times, and I still don't remember about that. Like, every time it gets brought back up in this book, I'm like, oh, yeah, 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 yeah. But, yeah, don't feel bad.
So, and the passenger has a really low opinion of Harry. Mm-hmm. Like, on some personal.
Yeah.
You know, like, just, he calls him a thug. You know, his talents make him good at destruction, but there's not much else there. You know, he's something that we can prod and direct, but that's it. Mm-hmm. And he says that, Grey Cloak says to him, it amazes me that someone like you survived
mm-hmm.
a run-in with Harry Dresden. I think he calls him an idiot.
Yeah, yeah. Or an imbecile or something. Because he's just like, this guy is just like, oh, he's so full. Oh, yeah, here it is. That an idiot such as you survived crossing the wizard once. So, yeah, basically he's listening to this dude be like, oh, whatever, this guy's nothing. And he knows perfectly well that that is not true. Right. And is just letting this guy talk, listening in complete, like, bafflement and amazement.
Yeah, yeah. And it sounds like the Grey Cloak has a much higher level of respect for what Dresden can do and the skills he mm-hmm. has and how smart he is. And this other guy doesn't. And I think it's also, I mean, it's very clear. He calls him an idiot to his fucking face. So he has very little respect for this guy.
Yes, that's true also.
And then so they're talking and they start talking about a circle or the circle. And also, what is K-I-N-E?
Kine. Kine.
At the Kine.
Yeah. So where is this line? Let's see. to be honest, I'm surprised the wizard lived the night. If he'd killed him, we could have claimed credit for a demise, and it would serve our purposes. I'm trying to find, where's the line that he says about?
It says,
oh, will he strike at the Kine soon? So Kine, I'm going to read you the official, definition. Archaic plural of cow.
Oh.
Mm.
Wait, what?
Yeah. Basically, calling regular vanilla human beings cattle.
So, okay. I'm so confused.
What?
Because he says,
will he strike at the Kine soon? Grey Cloak asked, referring to the Scavis, I presumed.
Oh, okay. Okay. All right. So they're talking about whether, you said it was Scavis?
Mm-hmm.
So they're talking about whether or not he's going to attack somebody else.
Soon. Right. One,
or multiple people.
Soon. One of the other cattle.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay. Oh.
Right.
Yikes.
Yeah.
Yikes. That's us.
That is
he's talking about us. That hurt my feelings.
He's one step away from being like, wake up, sheeple.
I was so prepared for it to be something completely different, like another kind of supernatural power or creature. These motherfuckers are talking about us.
It's just, like I said, disrespectful.
Did you hear how upset I was?
I just love, like, the different levels, because at first you didn't quite get it, and you were just kind of like, wait, what? And then as it sank in, the, oh. Yeah, that was good.
Oh, now I'm offended. Now radio. I might put this book down. All right, okay. So, all right. So what we have going on here is we have two people who we don't know who they are for sure in the car talking about this third actor, who is the one that is murdering the women. Mm-hmm. And then you have this Grey Cloak who we later find out in the next moment, because he is also something that likes to murder people.
Your sentences are so fragmented. So we have the one thing, but then the other turns out we find out that he...
There's a lot of things happening. There's, again, two guys, we don't know who they are, talking about a third guy we haven't met. And then we find out the Grey Cloak is killing in a similar fashion to the Skavis. Mm-hmm. Only... we find out much later when he's talking, when Harry is talking to Karen, that there's like a whole despair thing versus fear thing. Mm-hmm. But the Grey Cloak is working kind of like the Skavis is. And also that the passenger wants to meet someone that the Grey Cloak works for, and he hasn't been allowed to meet them yet.
Right.
So it's a lot.
It is a lot.
And they're also a... I'm sorry.
No, you go ahead, please.
I was just going to say, there's also a moment where they talk about how they weren't successful in killing Dresden, I'm assuming. That's who they're talking mm-hmm. about. And how they're going to have to answer for their failure to someone. And whoever that is not going to be really happy.
Mm-hmm.
And might just kill them for failing.
Indeed.
And the Grey Cloak is like, well, no. They won't get rid of tools they could still use.
Yeah, he says something about, like, they've asked for a progress report on you. And the other dude is like, oh, really? What are you going to tell them? And kind of insinuates that maybe you could do me a favor and just kind of, like, fudge it a little bit. To which Grey Cloak is like, lol, these motherfuckers will definitely kill me if they find out I was lying. They will kill mm-hmm, for lying, mm-hmm. no problem. So maybe you're going to be on the receiving end of some shit for failing, but we're going to be on the receiving end of way worse if they find out that I lied to them. So no, that's not happening.
The other guy is like, oh, they're hard but fair. Mm-hmm. And Grey Cloak is like, they're hard.
Yep.
Period. All right, so...
Although I'm realizing, because you said they failed to kill him, but then it says, if necessary, we can remove him. We have the resources for it. I could always... And Grey Cloak interrupts and says, I believe it premature unless he proves more threatening than he has been thus far.
Oh, you know what? You're right, because before that, they switch the conversation. Mm-hmm. He asked him, Grey Cloak asked the passenger, how is your endeavor going, basically? And he's like, it's going less than well. He isn't talking to me.
Right.
So that's when Harry realizes that they have someone. Oh, there's a lot mm-hmm, happening. Mm-hmm. This conversation isn't very long, but the passenger gets out. Harry has to decide, who does he want to follow, the passenger or the Grey Cloak? He decides that the passenger is, he knows someone that he's faced that's survived. Mm-hmm. And that if he was able to deal with him once, he could probably deal with him again. So he's going to stick to following the Grey Cloak.
Right.
Harry is like, the circle? Is that could be the Black Council? Which I'm not ready to go down that rabbit hole. So let's just pretend that he doesn't say that.
Yeah, can I tell you how much I chortled when you were like, Black Council, very original. I keep thinking about that because I think that Harry thinks it's very clever.
Oh, I thought that he admitted that it wasn't clever.
I like, well, maybe. But I don't know.
I can't remember. So he follows the Grey Cloak and they end up in Undertown. And I hate it. I do.
You hate Undertown, like specifically, or you hate this sequence of events?
Oh, I hate all of
it.
But Undertown, which was really cool and is a very cool idea. It's really neat that he includes it in the stories. It's really cool that it's based on, like, you know, fact. I think when we first started reading these, someone shared it with us, you know, that it's a real thing. But the more I think about it and the more that I understand that it is a real situation, it's happening under the city of Chicago, I find it deeply unnerving. I would prefer that this had been completely made up.
So no visits to Chicago in your future to the...
Not again. Yeah. No. you know, there's a whole thing with, like, subterranean, you know. What is that thing Elaine says? The Chuds.
Oh, God, yeah.
She's trying to write that book for Peterman. So that's already just ripe for, like, all kinds of anxiety and nightmares and shit. But then you take a real, actual place in the United States, like Chicago, and then you tell me that it has an actual, like, basically a city underneath itself. You know, that he's just sunk into the, you know, to the ground. And then you have a writer says, let me fill this place
with things. With
the worst things you can imagine. Yep.
Or, so, oh my God, how amazing would it be if we have, like, these really serious supernatural creatures trying to do their business in the shadows. Meanwhile, there's an illegal dance-off happening between a bunch of teenagers who have zero regard for this weird-looking dude in the gray cloak who's obviously just LARPing or something.
Like, crews are just battling down there?
Yes. Oh, my God. I would love this so much if Harry, like, went into Undertown to get to... And then he wound up, like, you know, befriending some...
some disaffected youths that only know how to express themselves.
I was going to just say some crunkers, but yeah, sure. Some disaffected youths who only know how to express themselves through dance. That's much nicer.
Harry is like that fucking Steve Buscemi gif. He's like, hello there, fellow kids.
How do you do, fellow kids?
Oh, God.
Anyway, I'm sorry, but I just got, like, too tickled by that whole idea. My mind really just goes places sometimes.
It really does.
I'm just like... have you watched Brooklyn Nine-Nine? Yeah.
Only a couple episodes here and there.
Because there's an episode where somebody's trying to set up Gina Linetti with a guy, and she says, I already know where I'm going to meet my future husband, at an illegal dance-off in an abandoned subway tunnel, where my love is the prize. Anyway.
I really need to watch that show. The few episodes I've seen, I really
like. It's so good.
Watched it.
And I had meant to bring it up at another point because, you know, we have that whole scene with Harry pretending to be Thomas's lover. And it's just kind of uncomfortable with the, like, oh, a straight guy pretends to be gay. So hilarious. But there are some episodes of Brooklyn Nine-Nine in which their gay captain pretends to be straight. And it's the most excruciating thing you've ever heard. He says something about how, like, you know how I am, Linda. I can't help myself when I see a pair of heavy breasts. Anyway, yeah, it's just like this, like, wording of somebody who clearly has no understanding of what men like about women. So, yeah, he follows Grey Cloak. And this motherfucker eats a power bar, which is crucial.
Oh, my God. He fucking shimmies up the wall.
Oh, I forgot about that.
And, like, that gets no play. Like, there's not even a moment of being like, what the fuck is this motherfucker just crawling up the wall?
Yes, I forgot about that.
I had to read it twice. I was like, did he pull down his secret ladder that Harry didn't see?
Where is that part? I'm trying to find it now.
We get the description of Undertown. He sneaks in through a crack.
Slipped inside it, then pressed his hands and feet against either wall on the inside of the cleft and climbed up it with rapid precision.
Mm-hmm.
8 or 9 feet up, it opened into a room with 3 walls of brick and 1 of earth. That's right, I forgot about that.
Mm-hmm. So, then he does this thing, which I've seen this somewhere before, too. I think it was Supernatural. It might have been something else, but I feel Supernatural is a good guess. He gets a little bit of blood, puts it in this weird bowl he has, slides his fingertips around it, and it turns, and you know, chants, and it turns into like a two-way. Mm-hmm. He's FaceTiming somebody.
Indeed. They call it blood timing, but close enough. Yeah.
TM. and this thing pops up, and it's wearing a heavy cloak and a cowl, and then Harry starts talking about it the last time he had seen Cowl, mm-hmm. which was in the Deathbeat books.
Yep. Deadbeat.
Right? The Dark Hallow. Deadbeat. Deadbeat. Good God. Lemon.
Deathbeat doesn't sound... That's nothing. Deadbeat's a thing.
Yeah, no, I know.
I'm just saying.
I mean, I don't know. I mean, I'm agreeing with you. You're correct.
Right.
My good God, Lemon was at my side.
Oh, okay.
How dare you assume?
We are just out of pocket tonight. That's all it is. That's what's happening.
Okay. So he reminds us, you know, when he had run into Cowl before, and he starts to say to himself, well, it really could be anyone because I don't legit know what this fucking guy looks right. like. It could be anybody running around in this getup. It's not that uncommon to dress up like this, which is a whole other thing. wait, what is happening here? Oh, no, Harry's still talking about how bad it was when he got his ass beat by him. And then he hears a little bit of their conversation.
Yeah, and this guy is like, you know, says... They first start talking off about the dude trying to say that they're the one guy wants to take Dresden out. Mm-hmm. And obviously this dude is just like, why the fuck would we do that? He's just got some personal problem with him. That's not what this is about. There's nothing to be gained by taking him out right now. And also the fool with you, still ignorant, my lord. I can preserve or dispose of him as you see fit. Which is cold-blooded.
Oh, it doesn't bode well for that passion.
Sure don't.
and the way that the conversation starts, where Cowl is like, you failed, and he's... I love this fucking positive thinking. I have not yet succeeded.
Yes.
But and he says, the curtain has not fallen, which is a weird way to phrase whatever it is they're trying to
accomplish. It's basically the fat lady hasn't sung yet.
Oh,
you
okay.
know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, the show's not over.
Okay.
Yeah.
Again, weird way to say
that's
that.
That's fair.
Methinks
he is a drama queen.
Oh, that's my God. and so, yeah, getting Dresden involved, Cowl is not happy. Mm. And you're right. They talk about how it's not going to be worth their time, you know, to kill Dresden, to jeopardize their whole operation. Mm. And Grey Cloak is like, look, this dude did not get me involved in this decision.
Yeah, I would like it so put that, on the record that right? I had nothing to do with this choice he made.
Make a note. That was that motherfucker, not me. They're talking about, I guess, really, like, Dresden is kind of a threat to what they've got going on. So Cowl wants to make sure that Grey Cloak is taking precautions. You know, you sure you're not followed? Are you sure? And the guy's like, yeah, I'm totally sure. He hasn't followed me in the flesh, which I thought was a really interesting distinction for him to make. Because as soon as he says, I was not followed in the flesh, Cowl takes a minute to take a look around. Yeah. And he fucking sees Harry.
He sure does.
Or senses him, or however that fucking works. And that's when he puts the whammy down. Harry calls him Darth Bathrobe.
Oh my God. One of my favorite lines. Like, I sometimes when Harry tries to be pithy or, you know, I'm just like, Harry, resist the temptation. You're not that good at it.
Mm-hmm.
But then there's moments like this where I'm just like, no, that's pretty good. Darth Bathrobe.
Yeah. It's. I mean, he fucking pays for that shit, though.
He does.
Like, he probably should have just left and not screamed anything. But, you know, Harry's gonna Harry.
He spoke a word that resonated in my head and thundered through the hazy confines of Grey Cloak's hideaway. Though I had braced myself to gather my will and pit it against his next strike hammered into me like a freight train. I could no more have resisted it than I could have stopped an ocean tide, and I felt it throwing me back and away. In that last second before I was banished, I reached out with all the strength I had left, focusing on Grey Cloak, pouring everything I had into the spell to grant me a clear view of his face. I got it for the barest instant, the face of a man in his mid-30s, tall and lean and wolfish. And then there was a geyser of scarlet pain, as if someone had seized both halves of my skull and torn it into two pieces. Darkness followed.
Yeah.
Whoopsies.
Yeah, that's a lot. yeah, it's not great. It's not great for our friend Harry. And so he's knocked the fuck out. And Molly ends up coming and waking him up because Karen has been trying to reach him and no one's answered. So they've asked her to come and make sure he's okay.
Mm-hmm.
And he is just barely okay.
Yeah.
And Little Chicago is fucked. I mean, Bob says they can fix it in like a week or so, but it, like, the damage, when you look at it, and then Harry is like, that would have been my head. That would have been my whole head.
Mm-hmm.
If it weren't for the fact that, you know, he had wards on his apartment, and that it was, like, the wards on the apartment, plus the model of Chicago itself kind of...
being a buffer.
Yeah, you know, it kind of weakened the spell, so that by the time it actually hit... the physical Harry, it was, you know, only a fraction of what it had been.
Right.
Because otherwise, it would have took his head clean off. Which is, again, I say, yikes.
Yikes. Indeed.
So then the chapter ends with just Karen comes over and he fills her in. And this is when he starts telling her what he thinks is going on.
Mm-hmm.
And what he has decided, determined, deduced, is that the Grey Cloak is actually a Malvora,
mm-hmm.
which was, I had forgotten about this shit too.
That's fair.
Another one of the big houses from the White Court.
There's a lot to keep track of in these stories.
There really is. So, there really fucking is. So, he has to explain to her what Cowl was, because, as he says, oh, that's right, you were in Hawaii with your boy toy at the time, when all that shit went down.
Hee hee.
And she's like, first of all, that's a man toy.
I love that so much.
I did too. I really did.
And I love that, like, that over there, Molly is like listening and pretending that she's not listening. And when when Karen says that, she drops her book on her face and then has to pick it up and pretend to keep reading. But Harry sees that she has it upside down because she's just very distracted, understandably.
Oh, God. So he brings her up to speed on all that shit. And we don't know yet how Cal survived what we all thought was him being dispatched, you know?
Right.
It was a pretty powerful blow, and I would have thought that he would have been dead. Seemed reasonable.
Mm-hmm.
But here we are.
Yeah, the fact that he's not dead is worrisome.
Yes, to put it mildly.
This motherfucker's a lot stronger than even I think Harry knows.
And what, like, Harry says that, you know, he wasn't sure if it was actually the same person, because he tells Karen that he's pretty sure Cal's human or had been at one point.
Mm-hmm.
But when Cal addresses Harry, he's like, the venom in his voice, you know, the anger, like, that was him.
Yeah.
It's the same guy. And he's thinking that Grey Cloak is a Malvora, and that the passenger has got to be Beckett. And he's super proud of himself.
Yep.
He takes a quick minute to explain to her why he thinks it's the Malvora. And he says it's because of the conversation when they're talking about the Scavis, how it kills. The Grey Cloak mentioned something about
the anticipation.
The anticipation, right?
Yeah.
And then like you said earlier, Karen has to be like, oh, but you know, that theory sounds great. But he died 7 years ago.
Wow, good job. Yeah. No.
I love that. I love that moment too. Because she could have like interrupted him earlier.
Yep.
And she's like, yeah, that's a sound theory, but it can't be right.
The little moments like that are very satisfying, because like Harry is almost always the guy who knows in the room.
Right.
So and when there's any moment that she gets to tell him his business, I'm always happy about it.
And he's on such a roll, right? Mm-hmm. Like he's been talking for a couple minutes, you know, bringing her up to speed, telling her what he found out, and you know, now what his theories are and how he's pretty much cracked the case. And she's just like, yeah, no. And when he keeps talking, like you said earlier, and then like halfway through his sentence, he does the whole like, what? And she just goes, died.
I don't know if you're familiar with the term. Some people call it passing on. Yeah.
Oh, my God. And so they talk about like, you know, Is she sure her information is right? Was it really him? I'm going to throw my vampire theory out there, even though it's probably nonsense and bullshit.
That you think Cowl's a vampire?
No. That Beckett might be a vampire.
Oh, that Beckett's... Oh, so you think that he was dead, but he's actually a vampire. So everybody saw the body and they had the funeral, but he's like still out there alive.
Yeah, but I mean, that's utter nonsense.
I really like it, though.
But I feel like Harry was so confident.
Although, you know, the whole way that vampires are made in this universe, like, obviously they can be made via bite. Like, that's part of what they were doing in book 3 to some of those kids, was, like, convincing them that they could be turned, and Susan got bit.
Mm-hmm.
But Susan doesn't die. Right? There's no like in True Blood, for example, where it seems like they've died and you bury them and you have to wait.
Right.
So
yeah, no, she's more like she just got infected.
Yeah.
More than, yeah. Hmm. So, okay, well then Harry's just completely wrong.
Yeah. Maybe. Who knows? I don't like to close any doors, I'm just saying.
Yeah, but I just...
That's why I would be a bad detective. Like... Because you need to be decisive and you need to be able to be like, okay, we're going with this theory. And I'm always like, but what if that's not it? What if there's an explanation for this that isn't that? Because there could be like six different reasons why he had his keys with him that night. You know, just like bullshit things like that that I see in TV shows. And I know that what's on TV isn't necessarily right. representative of how that works. But I would think that eventually you just have to narrow down your options. And so you make a commitment to a particular theory.
You absolutely have to do that
in real life
because I am having an issue at work. And one of the things that it's frustrating me is that I feel like people aren't considering all of the alternatives and all the possibilities. And that's really frustrating for me. But I guess the thing to do is to pick whatever you think is the most likely and focus your attention on that.
Yeah.
And I'm just like, but what about this, 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 and the other thing? Those could have also happened. Mm-hmm. And people are just like, yeah, no, we're going to focus on the one thing.
Yeah. I feel like there's some moment in another book where Murphy's like, well, or it could be this. And Harry says to her, let's not borrow trouble and go with the least like complex explanation. And I was like, now see, that's a good way to handle it. It's just not how I would handle it because I'm not, I am indecisive.
You like to borrow trouble.
I like love, I don't give it back. Are you kidding me?
I'm a trouble borrower.
I'm a trouble stealer, my friend.
All right, so we need to... All right, it's like midnight.
Sorry, yes.
So there's really not much more. They talk about what the fuck happened to Beckett.
Yep.
And she suggests that maybe Harry should take Mouse to Undertown and see if he can sniff anything out.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Harry is like, no, they do a really good job removing their scents because that's how vampires track each other. You know, he wouldn't leave anything. But, you know, maybe we'll find something.
Right.
And she makes a mention about a burned building.
Yeah, because of the fire the previous night.
Right.
And he has to be like, that wasn't my fault. She's like, I know it wasn't your fault, but that combined with, like, the fact that my car got blown up, like, pretty close by, this is going to attract attention.
Yeah.
And
it's the same device, like, the same, you know,
right,
whatever
right,
did
yeah.
her car.
Incendiary.
Mm-hmm. And she's worried about, like, who saw him at the scene, but he's like, it's fine. There was, like, a million people. And they decide that they need to focus on the real killer. Like, the Grey Cloak thing is interesting and it's good information, but let's focus on the thing that's, like, actively killing these women.
Right. So going after the Scavis primarily now.
Yeah. And there's talk of Thomas.
Yeah.
Which, you know, Harry still bristles at just the suggestion. And she has to, like, tread carefully, but she's like, look, he, you know, is probably somebody we should be asking about this kind of stuff. Have you heard from him? And Harry has to admit that I still haven't. I've heard left messages, but he hasn't called me back. And then it clicks that, actually, it doesn't click. Murphy just says it. I don't think it ever occurred to Harry.
Which part?
Where she says, what if the passenger has them?
Oh, right. Yeah.
And Harry kind of admits, like, you know what? Thomas really should have called me by now.
Yeah, he's starting to get concerned.
Yeah, because at first, when she brings him up, he's just kind of, like, defending him.
Mm-hmm.
Which, you know, I'm not mad at. And she has to really press, like, you know, could he do it? Could someone of the White Court do this? Is it at least physically possible?
Mm-hmm.
And
he keeps insisting, like, no, we know it's the Scavis. And she's like, you keep forgetting about that one woman who died and not in the throes of fear or in the throes of despair.
Despair.
She was in the middle of an orgasm when she died. So that's definitely not lining up with the MO of the other people that we're seeing here.
And when she asks about Thomas, he says he's more of a hired gun than a Seamus. I don't begrudge him not being suspicious of Thomas, you know?
Right.
I don't think I would like it if he was. I think I would be annoyed.
Exactly. There's a depth of trust there.
Mm-hmm.
I appreciate being there.
Yeah, same. I think I would be really disappointed if he went to doubting him and being suspicious that quickly.
Yeah, agreed.
Even though it a lot of it looks bad, I just feel like Harry is smarter than that.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that the relationship that they've built is more important, or is important enough to not let suspicion creep in.
Agreed.
So now the idea that maybe Thomas is actually in trouble, mm-hmm. in like real trouble, hasn't occurred to Harry at all. And it kind of stinks. And it's just like another thing on his plate now.
Yeah.
He asked if Karen was able to find out anything about that one woman, Jessica Blanche, and she hasn't yet.
Mm-hmm.
And he decides they need to catch up with Elaine and the rest of the women in the Ordo.
Yeah, the Ordo. I don't care for the word Ordo.
I don't either.
It sounds silly to me, but.
And they also decide that maybe if they can get to Helen Beckett, they can get some more information from her.
Mm-hmm. Like, that her husband's actually still alive. Don't lie, Harry. That's what you want her to say.
I think it's exactly what he wants her to say.
I really do.
My God, what if he's really still alive?
Oh, you're fixated. I love it.
I mean, like, he was like a low-level sorcerer or something, right?
No. I feel like Beckett was just there for the sorcery that the other guy
was
doing.
He was more like making money off of it or funding it or something somehow. I can't remember.
Yes, I really should refresh myself on exactly how that all went down. So maybe I'll do that in time for the next one, and then we can talk about that a little bit.
All right.
all right. So real quick, new patrons this week are Lauren, Joey, and Cassidy. So welcome to you lovely, wonderful people. I really appreciate you signing up. A couple of you have signed up at the $5 level, and that means that you're getting access to Game of Thrones, which good luck with that. And then we have two new reviews. I hadn't checked them in a long time. But we got one in February and one in March, and both are 5 stars. One of them says, 5 stars, so excited, my third endeavor with Unspoiled. Natasha somehow consumes media and puts out podcasts way quicker than I can listen to them, which, my production of podcasts is bananas, and I probably should chill, but here I am. So thank you to LDub12 for that. And then Away From Cars from the United States, 5 stars. You're all caught up. Wow. I hate seeing those words on my podcast feed for this show. I've read the Dresden Files several times, and I thought a podcast might be a way to get back into the flavor of them while I work. I had no idea this podcast would open up a new world for me. The idea of book clubs has never really spoken to me. I read too fast, and I'm not that good with schedules. But these two casters present such a fun and energetic book club that I want more. More, more, more. Everyone should give this a listen. Try a couple episodes, and you'll see. So thank you very much to Away From Cars.
Thank you.
I just hadn't checked reviews in such a while, so that's always a nice surprise. And if you guys haven't left a review, but you've been enjoying the show, please do that. It would be super helpful to us, and it's just a way to let us know that people are out there actually enjoying the work that we do. I think that's about it. Anything else that you want to mention before we wrap this sucker up?
I'm going to bed. I don't know what y'all are doing, but I'm going to bed.
I can't believe how late it got. I'm sorry. Every time. I swear to God. All right, guys. Thank you all. We love you. Toodaloo, motherfuckers.
Bye, guys.
was an Unspoiled Network podcast.